Gary Galo, who is an audio engineer emeritus from the Crane School of Music SUNY at Potsdam, New York. His topic is going to be on Redbook de-emphasis using the iZotope RX EQ module. And I'll just give a quick synopsis of the blurb we sent out. And it says, many early digital recording systems used analog high-frequency pre-emphasis ahead of the analog-to-digital converters as a means of improving the poor low-level high-frequency performance of early converters. A complementary analog de-emphasis curve was applied in playback after the digital-to-analog conversion. The Sony Philips Book of Specifications for the Compact Disc, also known as Redbook, included optional pre-emphasis and de-emphasis curves with time constants specified at 50 and 15 microseconds. Some early CDs, mostly discs made in Japan by Denon, those were the first ones that anybody ever saw, going back to what, about 1982, I think it was?
Yeah,
it's really the dawn of CDs, employed this option. Several early digital recording systems, including the popular Sony PCM-F1, also employed pre-emphasis and de-emphasis equalization using the same time constants. Some 40 years later, audio engineers and archivists are faced with myriad problems in transferring obsolete digital formats such as these to modern digital audio standards, not the least of which is how and where to supply quote-unquote Redbook de-emphasis when needed. This presentation will describe the nature of the Redbook pre-emphasis and de-emphasis curves, including an analysis of these curves based on computer solutions.
Simulations,
thank you. These computer simulations can be used to create a precise de-emphasis curve applied in the digital domain using the equalization module included with the popular iZotope RX restoration software. This presentation will describe the evolution of the digitally applied de-emphasis, the problems associated with some of the earlier efforts, and the final settings developed by iZotope RX EQ module. Frequency response measurements based on computer simulations will be shown, verifying the accuracy of the final version, along with the errors inherent in some of the earlier efforts. This presentation is a slightly updated version of the one given at ARSC at the annual conference in May of 2022, 5 months ago. Gary Galo, retired in 2014 after 38 years as audio engineer at the Crane School of Music SUNY at Potsdam. He is an active ARSC member since the 80s and has given numerous presentations at ARSC annual conferences, many of which have been published in the ARSC Journal, and has written a myriad book and recording reviews for the journal. He has also been a regular presenter at ARSC at the New York chapter meetings. He was the sound recordings review editor of the ARSC Journal from 1995 to 2002 and co-chair with me of the ARSC Technical Committee from 1996 to 2014. He is a life member of the AES, Audio Engineering Society, and a member of the Boston Audio Society, as well as the Societe Wilhelm Furtwängler and the Furtwängler Center of Japan. Without further ado, I've said enough. I'm turning the whole thing over to Gary.
Thank you.
We can probably take that microphone too. Well, thank you all for coming. I'm sure some of you have been around long enough to remember the early days of digital audio, and some of you probably had hands-on experience making digital recordings on systems like the Sony PCM-F1, which is now about 40 years old. There was a time when transfers of old recordings involved only analog material, but back then most of us couldn't have imagined that we would someday be dealing with transferring obsolete digital recordings to modern standards. But here we are, and indeed we've been here for quite a while. Now, back in 2018, I gave a presentation on transferring PCM-F1 recordings, which I expanded on at the ARSC virtual conference last year. And today I'm going to focus on one aspect of early digital recording systems and compact discs, the Redbook pre-emphasis curve, and a method for implementing the complementary de-emphasis curve in the digital domain when transferring these old recordings. There's a lot of technical information, a lot of slides, which I wouldn't expect anyone to get it all the first time around. I will put my email address up on the last slide, and if you'd like a copy of the slideshow to go through it again at your leisure and at your own time frame, I will send it to you. So you'll have a chance to look at it again if you'd like. I'd like to begin with a look at the Red Book specification for pre-emphasis and de-emphasis and the equalization curves that result. And as many of you probably know, the so-called Red Book was a book of technical specifications for the compact disc that was developed jointly by Sony and Philips. Now, pre-emphasis was a high-frequency boost that was applied during the record process ahead of the analog-to-digital converters in early digital recording systems. It was an option in the Sony Philips Red Book of specifications for the compact discs. All Denon CDs from the 1980s had pre-emphasis, but very few other CD manufacturers implemented it. It was also used in some early digital recorders, notably the Sony PCM-F1. And in my presentation on doing PCM-F1 transfers, I showed how the Tascam DA3000 digital recorder automatically applied de-emphasis if the sample rate converter was engaged, which you also needed to transfer those recordings. But if you don't use a DA3000 for your transfers, you need an accurate method of dealing with de-emphasis on your computer in the digital domain. Digital recordings and CDs made with pre-emphasis require a complementary de-emphasis or high-frequency cut during playback. Now, the most common explanation of why pre-emphasis was used on early digital recording systems was that it reduced quantization noise in the early analog-to-digital and digital-to-analog converters. That is true, but noise reduction was probably not the most important benefit. These early converters also had relatively poor linearity at high frequencies and at low levels, and the treble boost during the record process moved the high frequencies above the region where the linearity of the converters was at its worst. The Red Book pre-emphasis curve is defined by two time constants, 50 microseconds and 15 microseconds. Now, they correspond to turnover frequencies of 3,183 Hz and 10,610 Hz. Now, the high frequency boost begins at 3,183 Hz or 3.183 kHz, and it shelves, in other words, it flattens out at 10,610 Hz or 10.61 kHz. Now, all of these graphs with black backgrounds and colored traces were created by computer simulations. Now, if you're curious, I use CircuitMaker 2000 as my schematic drawing and simulation program, which uses a SPICE emulation engine, which is an industry standard. Now, it's been around for a long time, as you can tell from the name, but it still works really well, and mercifully, it still runs under Windows 10. Now, the record boost and shelf is shown by the green trace in the top graph. The yellow trace shows the complementary cut that must be applied in playback and in order to restore a flat frequency response. Now, the pre-emphasis and de-emphasis were applied with analog filters, and all analog filters have phase shift that varies with frequency. Now, back in 2009, I gave an ARSC presentation on phase equalization as it applies to disc recording and playback curves, and I pointed out that when analog filters apply complementary frequency response, complementary phase response is automatic. It comes along for the ride. We don't even need to think about it. That was published in the ARSC Journal in spring 2010, if you'd care to look at it. Now, this isn't always true of digital filters, and I'll get into more of that later. The bottom graph shows the complementary phase responses of the pre-emphasis and de-emphasis filters, and the maximum deviation from linear phase is about 32 degrees at around 5,800 Hz. These are simplified block diagrams of the Sony PCM-F1 recording and playback chains. Basically, in the analog domain, you have an analog input going through a buffer amplifier and two analog filters, the pre-emphasis filter, which applies the pre-emphasis that I have just described, and then an anti-aliasing low-pass filter, which is a steep brick wall filter that gets rid of everything above half the sampling frequency. And then in the digital domain, we have analog to digital conversion, digital filtering, and finally storage, which was normally on a beta videotape. This is one of the beta tapes I recorded way back when. And then in playback, we retrieve the data from the storage, from the digital beta tape. We go through digital to analog conversion with digital filtering, and then we're in the analog domain. We have two more analog filters, an analog low-pass filter, which basically gets rid of all of the sampling artifacts and turns a staircase waveform into a nice smooth waveform like what went into the buffer amplifier in the input to begin with, and finally the playback de-emphasis filter and an analog out. Now, I should mention that once again that the pre-emphasis and de-emphasis filters are analog filters. They provide the complementary frequency response and the complementary phase response. And again, we don't need to think about the phase response. It happens automatically. Here are a few block diagrams that show the evolution of de-emphasis in CD players. First, the top diagram. This is typical of the earliest CD players. Whoops. Let me back up here. Wrong button. There we go. We retrieve the data off the compact disc. We go through digital to analog conversion and digital filtering. And then in the analog domain, we have an analog low-pass filter, just like we have in the PCM-F1. And finally, analog de-emphasis and an analog output. But by the mid-1990s, some CD player and outboard D to A converter manufacturers had dispensed with the de-emphasis filter, because very few commercial CDs actually implemented pre-emphasis. Some manufacturers decided to save some money by getting rid of it. So you can see in the analog output, you have your analog low-pass filter, but the de-emphasis is missing. And again, it was just a cost-cutting measure. But by the early 2000s, large-scale integration had allowed integrated circuit manufacturers to combine digital filtering and D-to-A conversion into a single chip. And at that point, many IC manufacturers began incorporating de-emphasis into these chips, applying it with digital filters. And it didn't cost the player manufacturers anything to implement it, because it was already built into the chips. So de-emphasis came back after a point in time, which is a good thing because it makes the players backwards compatible. And more recently, de-emphasis has been found in sample rate converter chips, as like the Cirrus Logic chip that Tascam uses in the DA3000, and also in some digital output transmitter chips. Now, the pre-emphasis and de-emphasis curves are actually created with shelving filters, and a shelving filter is actually made by combining two curves. And I'd like to take a look at how the de-emphasis playback filters are combined and what happens when we combine them. These are the simplest types of analog filters. They are 6 dB per octave analog filters, meaning that above or below the turnover frequency, they attenuate at the rate of 6 decibels per octave. So these filters have gradual slopes, like you see in the graph here. They're not brick walls. And they're not flat right up to the turnover frequency. At the turnover frequency, they're actually 3 dB down. The turnover frequency is the 3 dB point for the filter. Now, this is one of the filters that we need to create the de-emphasis curve. It's a low-pass filter that's 3 dB down at 3,180 hertz relative to the low end of the spectrum, and then it rolls off above that at 6 decibels per octave. Now, the second filter is a shelf at 10,760 hertz, and relative to the high end of the spectrum, the turnover frequency of 10,610 hertz is at a level of plus 3 dB. Now, I've shown the two filters separately in the top illustration. The cursors are at the two turnover frequencies. The bottom illustration shows the two curves combined to produce the de-emphasis curve. Now, you might expect that once they're combined, the turnover frequencies will still be the 3 dB points. But they're not. The two turnover frequencies are actually fairly close together, so there's an interaction between them. Now, I discussed how filters can interact in more detail in my presentation on the Columbia LP equalization curve back in 2008. That was in the ARSC journal in spring 2009. The interaction and phono equalization curves are equally applicable here. Once the two curves are combined, 3,183 Hz is at minus 2.6 dB relative to the low end of the spectrum, and 10,610 Hz is at plus 2.6 dB relative to the high end of the spectrum. There's simply not enough space between those two turnover points for the slope to ever reach 6 dB per octave. It never really gets there. Now, this isn't terribly important right now, but it's something to bear in mind when we're making measurements on analog shelving filters, or digitally created ones. So in order to verify the accuracy of playback de-emphasis, whether it's applied in the analog or the digital domain, I needed a series of test tones with levels conforming to the pre-emphasis standard. And if the playback de-emphasis is accurate, the playback filtering should produce a flat frequency response. I had become frustrated by the fact that there weren't any test CDs with enough test tones to measure the accuracy. They all had a handful of tones, and it would tell you if the de-emphasis was working, but it wouldn't do anything to tell you what the accuracy was. So back in 2007, I decided to take matters into my own hands, and I made a test CD with a large number of test tones, and I created those test tones using SoundForge, which is still my main digital editor. Now, in most of the simulations that follow, I plotted only the frequency response from 20 Hz to 20 kHz, since 20 kHz is close to the upper limit of any of the old formats that used pre-emphasis. Now, as we're going to see, I was initially following iZotope's lead, and I'm going to have more to say about that later. The first step was to run a computer simulation of the Redbook pre-emphasis and de-emphasis curves. This is the pre-emphasis simulation. The 6 dB per octave filters normally have one capacitor and one resistor, and the two filters we need can be combined into one network with two resistors and a common capacitor, which we see up here. The formulas are here for calculating the component values. You don't need to get bogged down on those now. You can look at the slideshow later if you'd like, after I send it to you. But these resistor and capacitor values produce a mathematically ideal network, which is important. Now, this is the de-emphasis simulation. The network's exactly the same, but the orientation is different. This is a shunt filter. The previous one was a series filter. I don't want to get bogged down on these two slides. Again, if you want to look at them in more detail, just ask me for a copy of the slideshow. Most circuit simulation programs will allow you to compare the levels between two cursors, which you can move around as you wish. Circuit Maker will also give you a text file with levels at many more frequencies than you'll ever need. A piece of one of those text files is over here on the left. Now, from this data, I was able to determine the exact levels relative to 20 Hz of all the tones that I felt I needed for testing, and the chart on the right shows all of that data. Now, SoundForge has two useful plugins that I use to create the tones. The first is Simple Synthesis, and Simple Synthesis allows you to generate several types of waveforms, and what we want for this are sine waves. You can adjust the frequency, the length, and the level of each tone. And the FX volume plugin on the bottom allows us to adjust the level to a resolution of 1/1000th of a dB. And that kind of accuracy is actually quite important if we're going to determine accuracy down the road. So the first thing I did was create 28 test tones between 20 Hz and 20 kHz, all set to a level of minus 10 dB. In other words, no high frequency pre-emphasis, and this was done with the Simple Synthesis plugin in SoundForge. Those test tones are in the left-hand side of the SoundForge editing window. The next thing I did was I took those same 28 tones and I created the pre-emphasis by adjusting the level of each tone to match my pre-emphasis computer simulation, and I did those level adjustments with FX volume, and those test tones are shown on the right-hand side of the editing window. So the 28 tones with pre-emphasis are the ones that we need for de-emphasis testing. So now I'm going to get into the nitty-gritty of this presentation. Basically, how to do digital equalization correction and how to measure its accuracy. Digital de-emphasis, again, is applied using a high shelf filter, and there are three settings that we need to consider. The first is the gain. We need to measure the total level difference between the lowest and the highest frequencies, in this case, 20 hertz and 20 kilohertz, or at least that's what I thought at first. As we'll see shortly, I'm following iZotope's lead for now. The level difference here is 9.49 dB. So the midpoint gain, or the midpoint level, is half that, or 4.75 dB. Now it's important that the midpoint gain, if we're using a shelving filter that is creating a cut, the midpoint gain is actually going to be expressed as a negative number. So we have a total level difference, 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz, of 9.49. The midpoint level is 4.75, which we need to enter as a negative number, and that's important. So the next thing we need to do is to locate the frequency at which that level is at a midpoint of 4.75 dB, and the computer simulation shows us that the frequency is 5,245 hertz. So frequency is the next parameter that we need to concern ourselves with. The last setting is Q, which stands for quality factor, and in simple terms, the lower the Q, the more gradual the roll-off, which is what you see on the left, and the higher the Q, the steeper the roll-off, like you see on the right. These are screen captures of the iZotope RX equalization module's high shelf filter, and the left-hand one is set for a Q of 0.5, and the right-hand one is set for a Q of 2.0, and you can see the difference in the slopes in the graph that RX gives you. Now, if you use SoundForge 10 and 11, okay, let me back up here. The Q setting for a 6 dB per octave shelving filter is always 0.5. Now, the cursors on the graph, again, show the two turnover points. So you can see that this 0.5 Q setting looks very similar to this graph over here. Now, if you use SoundForge versions 10 and 11, you may remember that they came with an iZotope plugin called Mastering Equalization. And Mastering EQ had presets for the Redbook pre-emphasis and de-emphasis curves. They called de-emphasis post-emphasis. And iZotope's post-emphasis settings were a mid-frequency of 5,225 hertz, a level of minus 4.7 dB, and a Q of 7.00. Now, how they arrived at this Q setting is a mystery to me, but they don't offer any explanation about the type of filter emulation they were using. You'll notice that the third column over here is actually marked Q slash slope, and here are the high shelf settings on the bottom. That's the one they have checked, and the numbers that I just indicated. But 7.00 doesn't seem right for either Q or slope. So again, I don't know how they came up with that number. Now, iZotope seems to have arrived at their frequency and level settings based on a bandwidth of 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz, as I alluded earlier, but they were a little bit sloppy. And I'm going to examine that more closely shortly. So using the test tones that I created with pre-emphasis, I checked the accuracy of the iZotope Mastering EQ preset using SoundForge's statistics function. First thing I did is I ran the Mastering EQ preset on a series of test tones, and then you simply highlight about half of each tone in the middle, and you note the level. In this case, maximum sample value is the one that we want. That's shown by the red arrow there. And then I put the results into an Excel spreadsheet. And the first thing I did is I entered the dB measurements I got from SoundForge's statistics. That's the middle column. And then I added 10 dB to each to put the 20 hertz reference at 0 dB. And then finally, and that gives the result shown in the right column. Whoops, we've lost that. There we go. And then the spreadsheet then calculates the total deviation from 0 dB, or a perfectly flat frequency response, and divides that by 2 to get the accuracy in plus or minus so many dB, and that's shown in the right column. So basically, we have the down at the bottom here, we have the highest level in the column, the lowest level in the column, the total spread, and plus or minus so many dB of accuracy. And then what I do is I take those results and I just plot them on an Excel graph. And the accuracy of the iZotope mastering EQ preset is plus or minus 0.43 dB from 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz. You can see that there's a pronounced peak at about 3 kilohertz and also a dip between 9 and 10 kilohertz. So this is not real great. When we design RIAA phono playback equalizers and high-performance phono preamps, we try to get the accuracy much better than that. The best RIAA phono preamps often measure plus or minus a tenth of a dB from 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz. Some of you may say, well, can you hear all this? But it has been shown that the human ear can detect very small deviations from a flat frequency response if they're spread over two or more octaves. And the nature of equalization errors is that they tend to be spread over two or more octaves. They're not confined just to a single frequency. And if the errors are in the region where the ear is most sensitive, they will definitely be audible. And 3 kilohertz is right in the ear's most sensitive region. Now, I did determine that the old mastering EQ program does provide the correct phase response. The small errors I observed were consistent with its frequency response errors. So much for the old iZotope mastering EQ program, which hasn't been available for about 10 years. So let's move on to the iZotope RX9 equalization module, beginning with some initial preparation. Now, when I started this project, I was using RX7, but I upgraded to RX9 earlier this year, and I now have RX10 on my office computer, all the advanced versions, but the EQ comes with all of them. The EQ modules are exactly the same in all of the various price points for iZotope RX. It doesn't come with the elements version. You need to get either the standard or the advanced version, but it has remained the same from version 7 through version 9 and version 10. So the first thing we need to do up here is select the default setting. And basically what you have to do, we're only going to use one of these things. So the next thing we need to do is select the analog filter emulation in the upper left. And I mentioned that the complementary phase responses of the pre-emphasis and de-emphasis curves, I mentioned that a little bit earlier. And as I mentioned, the complementary analog filters automatically provide the complementary phase equalization. Well, the RX equalization module's analog filter setting, it creates infinite impulse response minimum phase filters. And this is exactly what we need to duplicate the phase response of analog filters. And they note this in their online help and in their product description. And that's very good news, because now with an analog emulation being done in the digital domain, we can precisely duplicate both the frequency and the phase response of the analog filters. So the next thing we do, we simply select the high shelf filter from the lower left, which is here. And we, as I mentioned a few minutes ago, we turn off bands 1 through 5. We only want one band, so I happen to use band 6. You can use whichever one you want. But turn off all the other ones so they don't get in the way. And then in RX, open up the test tones. I save them as a wave file, so any of these programs will open them up. You want the waveform display only, not the spectral display. If you use RX, there's a slider that goes back and forth between the spectrum analysis, the waveform display, or an overlap of the two. We want just the waveform. We don't want the spectrum display. It just gets in the way. So the next thing we do is we set the frequency and the gain and the Q. Now, rather than use iZotope's old mastering EQ settings as the basis for my first attempt in RX EQ, I set the gain and the frequency according to my own computer simulation, which we looked at earlier. And my computer simulation from 20 Hz to 20 kHz showed that iZotope miscalculated the level and the center frequency in their own old mastering EQ plugin. So my simulation showed that the mid-frequency point is 5,245 Hz, and with a midpoint gain of minus 4.75 dB. And again, the Q is always 0.5 since the RX9 equalizer wants the real Q value and not the slope. Now the RX EQ module allows you to enter up to two decimal places in the gain and Q settings. Now if you click on them again, you'll see that the settings you've entered have been retained. The display rounds them off, but if you go to two decimal places, it does retain what you entered. And again, you can verify that just by clicking on each box there. I entered minus 4.75 dB for the gain. The display rounds it to minus 4.8. But again, that's only in the display. And you can save these settings using the pull-down menu at the top. You can save any of these custom presets that you have done. So the next thing we do, run those settings on the entire file. And next, we use RX's waveform statistics to measure each frequency. We open the waveform statistics over here, and we highlight again about half of each tone in the middle. Now this is a close-up of the RX waveform statistics module, and since the test tones are sine waves, sample peak, maximum RMS, minimum RMS, and total RMS are normally the same. You can just take your pick. On rare occasions, the sample peak level may be slightly different from the rest. Just go with the majority, or the one labeled maximum RMS level is the safest bet if there's any difference between them. Normally there isn't. So, like we did before, we insert the results into an Excel spreadsheet, and we plot the results on an Excel graph. And this one isn't very good, as you can see. It's not really much better than iZotope's old mastering EQ. All I've done is I've moved the errors to the top end of the spectrum. We've just moved them around. We haven't really made it any better. And the next question is, what's wrong with the settings I used? Well, what's wrong is pretty simple. I made the same mistake as iZotope with their mastering EQ, and here's what's going on. At 20 kilohertz, the filter is still falling in level. The shelf is still falling in level. It hasn't reached its final level. So the simulation from 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz isn't wide enough to give us that total level difference. That's the top graph. So what I did is I expanded the simulation and ran it from 1 hertz to 100 kilohertz. It's the upper frequency that's most important. Down here, it really doesn't matter much because you're so far away from where the shelf takes place. So I expanded the frequency response from 1 hertz to 100 kilohertz, and I'm going to mention now that there are formulas for calculating these parameters, and I'm going to get to these shortly. But for right now, I just want to go with my computer simulations. So the expanded frequency response gives us new settings, and the midpoint gain between 1 hertz and 100 kilohertz is now minus 5.2 dB. And that level occurs at a frequency of 5,780 hertz. Now, it's no coincidence that the midpoint frequency is also the point of maximum phase deviation. And you may remember earlier that I said the maximum phase deviation was around 5,800 hertz. Well, now we're pretty close to it. you can see that my initial values of minus 4.75 and 5,245 hertz were pretty far off, and iZotope's old mastering EQ values were even worse. So the expanded frequency response simulation gives us new settings. Here are the new settings. I ran the EQ settings on the test tones and plotted the results in an Excel graph. And as you can see, this one is a whole lot better. It's plus or minus about 25 thousandths of a dB from 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz, which is pretty close to a ruler flat response. Now, this is excellent accuracy, and we could just stop here. But as I mentioned a short time ago, there are formulas for calculating the center frequency and the level. And it's pretty obvious that iZotope didn't use them for their mastering EQ setting, but let's see what results we can get using the math rather than the computer simulations. And if we plug in the numbers, again, you can look at these formulas if you ask me for the slideshow. I won't get bogged down in them now. But if we plug the numbers into the formulas, we can see now that the new center frequency is 5,811.52 hertz. And the level, minus 5.23 dB. Once again, the Q is 0.5, just like it was before. And you'll notice that that center frequency using the math now corresponds precisely to the point of maximum phase deviation, which I showed earlier. So we can take these new settings and run them on the test tones, enter the results in a spreadsheet, and plot the results on a graph. And the new settings give us an accuracy of plus or minus 15 thousandths of a dB from 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz. Now, it's only a hundredth of a dB better than the simulation version, and I doubt that anybody can hear the difference between them. I know several ARSC members who saw my Zoom presentation in May. They have tried the simulation version. This one, based on the math, is now the one I consider to be the final version, but either one gives excellent results. We can't argue with either of them. And again, I doubt that anybody can hear the difference. So I want to thank you for bearing with me as I went through the various steps in the evolution from iZotope's early efforts to my own final results. But I hope this will help all of us in developing other applications for the RX EQ module. Because once you understand how to manipulate the shelving filters, there are a lot of other things you can do, and I'm going to talk about one or two of them at the end of this presentation. Some of you are probably wondering if you can use Ozone for this. Ozone is a mastering program that is made by iZotope, and among other things, it has an equalizer built in, and depending on which version of Ozone you get, at which price point, there are lots of other things it comes with as well. It's an iZotope product that can be used with any editing application that uses VST plugins, including RX. And if you buy the standard or the advanced version, it'll also run as a standalone program. The Elements version does not. But yes, indeed, you can use Ozone. Now, Ozone completely changed the equalizer interface when they introduced version 9, which is what I'm using. And I believe the equalizer is unchanged in version 10, which just came out, but I haven't bought version 10 yet. You don't need to purchase the expensive versions of Ozone. The equalizer comes with the Elements version, which is very inexpensive, and it's even being bundled for free with other software packages, including SoundForge. You buy SoundForge, you get Ozone for free. The Elements version, again, is the one I'm using. It has the equalizer, and that's all you really need. So for starters, we need to do some preliminary setup in Ozone. The first thing you need to do is turn off all the modules except the equalizer. You notice here the equalizer is lit up in cyan. The others are not lit up. You want to turn all the other ones off, because otherwise they're going to get in the way and affect the results of what you're doing. Then you need to go into the settings, and you need to make sure that the equalizer soft saturation is turned off. In other words, it's not checked. And finally, Ozone has input and output levels. You need to set them both to 0.0. So the next thing you need to do is select the Ozone 9 equalizer's analog module, which is here. And this is an IIR minimum phase filter, just like it is in RX9 and RX10. Now, ozone 9 gives you two choices of views. There's an all bands view and what they call HUD, which stands for heads up display. Now, the all bands view displays the settings for 8 different equalizer parameters all at once. And we only want one of them, so all the other ones need to be turned off. But if you're doing a mastering equalization on a recording or something, a lot of people have lots of different equalizations going on at the same time, but for what we're doing, we certainly only want one of them. So, what we need to do is select the high shelf filter over here, and the shelving filter, well, we need to select the high shelf filter and enter the same settings as before, except for Q. Ozone has its own definition of Q, which is very strange because it's written, it's also made by iZotope. When they ask for Q, they seem to really mean slope. But as we'll see shortly, the program isn't even consistent when we move from all bands to the HUD view. Now, the shelving filter Q for the all bands view is 5.44. And I determined this by trial and error, by simply fine-tuning and zeroing in on the setting that gave the exactly the same results as the RX EQ module. I can't explain why it works this way, and I can't get any clarification from iZotope on it, but in fact, that's how it works. The other two settings are basically the same. Now here's what's really strange. The Q for the HUD view is 11.2. Again, I determined this by trial and error. I simply zeroed in on it until I got exactly the same results as I get with the RX EQ module. And the other settings are, again, are basically the same. Now, again, why the two different views in Ozone 9 would require two completely different Q settings, neither of which is really Q, is a mystery to me. I've been trying to get clarification on this from iZotope, but they're not a very responsive company. The HUD view will display only one set of parameters at a time, whichever one you have selected, and be sure that only one is enabled. You need to turn all the other ones off. And you run the results in RX EQ or either Ozone 9 views are identical if you set the Q values as I've indicated here. So the last thing we need to talk about is phase correction. Now, a 32 degree error around 5.8 kilohertz isn't terrible, and it's certainly not even close to the phase distortion that has to be corrected in an RIAA phono preamp. But since the RX EQ module has an analog emulation, an accurate de-emphasis curve should also correct the phase shift of the pre-emphasis curve. And the question is how to verify phase correction. Some of you may remember this Denon test CD from 1984. It was one of the most useful test CDs made at the time, and it included 20 Hz to 20 kHz frequency sweeps with pre-emphasis off and pre-emphasis on. And I extracted those tracks from the CD. Now, using SoundForge, I put the sweep with pre-emphasis in the left channel and the sweep without pre-emphasis in the right. So here's the left with pre-emphasis, here's the right without it. And what I did is I carefully aligned the two channels at the beginning, and I saved that file. And then in RX, I ran the EQ on the left channel and using the final settings that I showed you a little bit earlier, and I saved that file. And I then simply played that file in SoundForge, and I watched the phase scope across the entire 20 to 20 kilohertz spectrum. The whole file is only 50 seconds long, so it won't take you very long. You just play it and sit back and watch the scope, and the list as you display on the scope shows excellent phase response across the entire spectrum. Now, using Adobe Audition, I zeroed in on the center frequency of 5,811 hertz, where the phase shifts of the filters should be at maximum. The Adobe Audition Phase Scope allows you to drop the cursor at any point in the file without actually playing the file, and it will give you the phase display at that instant in time. You don't have to play it. You just put the cursor there and it'll show it to you. I don't know of any other phase scope in any editor that will do that. This is a very handy feature, and I've used it for a number of ARSC presentations. And as you can see, the phase correction at the point of maximum deviation is excellent. So some of you are probably wondering if these differences in de-emphasis equalization are audible. So we'll see if we can find out. I'm not sure how much you'll be able to hear over this audio system, but it seems to be pretty decent, so we'll give it a try. This is the second movement of Mahler's Fifth Symphony, and it's from the excellent Mahler cycle with Eliyahu Inbal and the Frankfurt Radio Orchestra that was recorded by Denon back in the 1980s. And as I mentioned earlier, all Denon CDs from this period had pre-emphasis. What we're going to hear is the first minute or so of this movement. First is the original raw CD extraction without any de-emphasis, and it should sound rather bright. The second will be the same excerpt with de-emphasis applied with that old iZotope mastering EQ, which we found was not very accurate. And finally, the third one with my final iZotope RX EQ settings. So here is the first example, the original no de-emphasis. Thank you. So how many heard a difference between the two examples with de-emphasis? How many heard no difference? Anybody care to describe what you heard? Yeah.
Okay. I heard more room tone.
Okay.
More resonance in the recording, and of course, more of the bass, better defined. Actually, in the final one, the bottom end sounded a lot better defined.
Okay. You, I'm sorry?
Good, better, best.
Ah, okay. Any other comments? I'll tell you what I hear. I think that 3 kilohertz peak is audible. I think there's a slight rasp, a slight edge in that upper mid-range in the second example, and it just sounds a little bit smoother in the third example. And my wife heard the same thing on the computer audio setup at home. Yeah. So it's interesting because after I gave the presentation for the ARSC virtual conference in May, you never know what you're going to hear over the internet, but several people emailed me and they told me that even over the internet, the final RX9 version sounded better. And our old friend Doug Pomeroy wrote and he said, even with my 85-year-old ears, I could tell that the RX9 version was better. So that was encouraging. Well, there are other obvious applications for digital filtering, especially ones that have an analog emulation like this. And for me, the obvious one is phono equalization, which also requires an infinite impulse response minimum phase filter. I've been doing a lot of work in developing a set of archival phono equalization curves for RX9 and ozone, and the results are very promising. And I plan to give a presentation on digital phono equalization for the New York meeting right here next April. Now, RX EQ doesn't have a 6 dB per octave low pass filter, which you normally need to create the treble roll-off portion of a phono EQ curve, but I've been able to work around that by using a shelving filter and putting the shelving frequency high enough in frequency so there's virtually no effect within the audible spectrum. Right now, I've got it set to about 200 kilohertz, the upper shelf, but I found that with RIAA, I can actually set it as high as a megahertz so that the effect at 20K is almost non-existent. So that's very good news. Ozone has a 6 dB per octave low-pass filter. This is another thing I don't understand. The same company makes both programs. Ozone, they give you a 6 dB per octave low-pass filter. RX, they don't include it. It goes 12 and up, which is kind of crazy, but again, they seem to do things their own way. There's also the issue of tape equalization, and that's not nearly as simple, mainly because of the tape playback alignment issue. It's easy to create shelving filters to do an NAB and a CCIR curve for various tape speeds. It's not so easy if you have to do a machine alignment. And if you're transferring a tape by taking the signal right off the playback head fed to a flat preamp and you had test tones on the tape, you look at the level of the 1 kilohertz tone and you in your tape recorder, you adjust the 10 kilohertz level so it's the same level. I haven't figured out how to do that digitally and to do one without affecting the other. And Richard Hess and I have had quite a bit of correspondence about this and I can't say at this point, but we may come up with a solution. I don't know yet. This brings me to a few complaints that I have about iZotope RX, if anybody out there is listening. Again, no 6 dB per octave low-pass or high-pass filters in RX EQ. You can do this with ozone, but not with RX. There's no phase scope in RX. Every editor should have a phase scope. There's also no crossfade ability in RX, which any editor should have these days. The various RX9 modules don't support subfolders for presets. Ozone does, which I find very, very useful. In Ozone, I've created subfolders for phono EQ, digital de-emphasis. In fact, I've got 2 separate subfolders for phono EQ in the all bands view and 1 in the HUD view. RX doesn't support subfolders, so when I open up EQ, everything I've created is all in one folder. It's a little cumbersome. Again, Same company makes both. Why can't they do it the same way, both ways? I tend to think of RX as an audio restoration toolbox, and I think as such it's an excellent program. I don't use it as an editor, even though they call it that. And the lack of crossfadeability and the lack of a phase scope are two of the reasons. I still use SoundForge for all of my editing. If you use these programs and you agree with any of this, you can contact iZotope support and let them know, and I think your comments will probably go into a black hole, but who knows, you may get luckier than me. So, here are the final RX9 and ozone settings, in case you didn't get them all before, and if you want a copy of the slideshow as a PDF file, drop me an email, and I'll be happy to send it to you. Thank you. So, okay. We got time for a few questions.
Sure. Thank you, Gary. Any questions from our audience? Joe? Huh? Right. Well,
I'm an innocent when it comes to these things. So I just was fascinated.
Well, the examples were, you know, very, very.
You can
obvious.
Always ask me questions by email too, John.
Yeah.
iZotope and ozone. I think they call the company iZotope. I'll just talk loud. Weren't they recently bought by an American company?
Yeah, they were bought out. And we talked to Brad McCoy about that just the other night at dinner, and a lot of people are concerned about, you know, what direction this company might go in.
Yeah. Another quickie question, and I can give you my own answer from personal experience, but was there any pre-emphasis used on the Nagra D tapes? You remember, that's a very obsolete digital.
That I don't know.
Yeah, my experience with it, I've dubbed some. In what I was dealing with, the clearly the mic placement was such that you'd never hear it.
Yeah.
Because it was very dull on
now
the top.
Now, that Nagra that you did the Bach cello suites with.
Yeah.
This is what you're talking about.
Yeah. And, oh, I did a bunch of them.
Now, it had an SP diff output, right?
A what?
It had an SP diff digital output, right?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, you bet.
Okay. And it's at 44.1?
No. It's, yes. 48? Yes, it's 44.1.
It is 44.1.
There were settings on it. You could set different things.
There are some boxes out there. I've got a couple sample rate converters I built way back when that I put a light on that comes on when there's a pre-emphasis flag detected.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. But I don't know the answer to that.
And the tapes that I did, because of the way they were recorded.
I heard the Nagra had especially good converters for its day. What year was it made, do you know?
It was recorded in about 1992 or 3, and of course the machine was pre-existing.
Yeah.
So I can't tell you. It's a nightmare of a machine to use.
You told me a lot about it. And I mean, yeah, it sure sounds like it.
It's going to be very hard to find any of them that work.
Yeah.
I had access to two of them, only one of which worked, and not all of it worked.
Yeah, not only finding the machine, not only finding the machines that work, but finding the media that hasn't deteriorated to the point where you can't retrieve anything.
That's right. Among the tapes I had, which were all master tapes, some percent of them just don't play.
Yeah.
They just don't work.
You know? Yeah.
So, anyway.
Okay, Gary. I also think in Sadie, they have some preset curves. There's a plugin that can be put into the editor. I remember.
Oh, Sadie does.
Yes, for
de-emphasis.
For de-emphasis,
okay.
That could be used for DATs, CDs.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, they already came up with the curves, and I had one that where you put in the DAT, and immediately the emphasis light came on the Sony.
Oh, okay.
And yeah, like the difference you heard here. And then
sure.
I said, well, all right, let me run it in, then put in the curve and played it back in real time, and it's like, yeah, there is a difference.
That's good.
So
yeah.
You say that DAT recorders has a curve in it?
Oh yes, some of the very early DAT machines, not the first generation, but the ones after that. Which one would have they been? The PCM-300s?
The R-500s?
The R-500s,
and the R-700s.
Yeah, and there was an R-300, too.
I didn't use. I've got a couple of R-500s at school.
Yeah, these were the ones. They're not the first generation, not the old 2500s. This is the next generation, where everything was combined into one unit.
One thing you didn't mention.
Well, I'll just talk loud. I don't think this works.
Okay, yes,
there it
does.
All right. You didn't mention that the... the playback units were, back in the era when they were using this, had a flag in it, right? So if there was emphasis in the recording, the playback unit would notice it and know it's
there. The pre-emphasis was switched in automatically. There was a digital flag in the SPDIF data stream that told the player, kick in the de-emphasis filter.
That's rather important to know. I mean, you didn't happen to mention that, but you did before in other discussions.
Out of the control booth, Joe Patridge.
Well, I just we were talking about the DATs and the more modern. The earlier version was indeed the PCM 2500, the two-piece unit that was ridiculously big and heavy and didn't have absolute time and was a ridiculous machine that jammed very frequently. Yeah. Sony's second generation were the PCM R300, 500, and 700.
Yes.
And the 700 was the one that had a confidence head monitoring.
Right,
which other two did
not. It was a four-head machine,
Yeah, the 500 had AES I.O., whereas the 300 was only SPDIF and optical.
The ones I've got are 500s.
I got the 700s.
I didn't feel I needed the confidence monitoring because I was recording
you're only
live
back,
concerts.
Right?
And if the recording's no good, what am I going to do? Stop the performance, my recorder's not working.
Go back to letter D.
Well, did you record simultaneously on two machines?
Yes.
Oh, then
absolutely.
Then you're pretty safe.
I was a belt and suspenders guy when I first started using DAT, I was using it like the F1 along with an analog recorder. When I finally bit the bullet and scrapped analog tape, I was using two DAT machines simultaneously. And I would buy two different brands of tape, and I would use one brand of tape in the top machine and another brand in the bottom machine in case there was a bad batch of tape, belt and suspenders.
And Gary, how much do those DATs run at that time? If you got a good price, they're what,
$8-$9 each?
Yeah. What, at the beginning they were?
At the beginning they were more.
But I'm talking about by the time.
Yeah. About 18.
Did you find that you needed both versions?
Ah, that's an interesting question. Someone once told me that Sony DAT tapes don't work very well in Panasonic machines.
That's absolutely true.
Right. Yeah, guess who found out? Me.
You. The hard way.
If I hadn't had the recording on a different brand of tape in the other machine, I would have lost a couple of concerts.
By the way, there was something else, too, about certain DAT machine, certain DATs that were put out, TDK. Their housing was a little bit larger, was slightly out of tolerance than most of the other DATs manufactured. And depending on what machine you put it in, it jammed.
Yeah.
Yeah. I have to say that when it comes to the more modern DATs, I avoided the Panasonic SV series like the plague.
Yeah.
It had a terrible loading mechanism. It jammed. It ate tape. It was very hungry.
Oh, yes.
And it was there. To my, they sounded good. They had good
converters. They had pretty good converters,
they were unreliable.
I found that the 3500s and 3700s worked pretty well.
3500 better than the 3700.
The 3800 had a lot of problems.
You remember the funny trend where people were using data cassette tapes that looked just like the other ones?
Oh, no, no.
It didn't work very well. But
talking about L cassette?
No. They were data tapes. They were really computer.
Sure.
But they fit.
They fit the machine.
But the problem was with those that they were data tapes, but they were very thin. In other words, if you were to put them in, they were equivalent of not even a 2. A
they were 180.
180s.
Yeah.
R180s.
I was going to mention something along those lines. One smart thing they did for DAT audio recording is that when you went from, the 60-minute to 120, when you went to longer tapes, the tape thickness was the same. They just loaded more tape into the shell.
Correct.
That wasn't true of the data tapes.
No, because the data tapes couldn't at the standard millimeter thickness of the 60s and 120s, they couldn't fit it in the case. So they made it slightly similar to analog cassettes. Same thing.
Came out with the 180s.
I only used Sony tapes for one semester, by the way. I learned my lesson.
Sony digital? DAT tapes?
Yeah,
really?
Because the Sony tapes and the Panasonic machines.
Oh, because you had Panasonic machines.
Yeah.
Right. There was something else, too. I have one of the Cadillac machines, the 7010, the big monster. Sony put out, we found out later on with the experiments, the PDPs, which were the professional grade, they put out a standard grade. Two of them broke in my machine. The PDPs I never had a problem with. There was a quality of tape in the standard.
And you're talking about in the 7010.
Right.
The 7010 had a, what I consider to be a fairly rough loading mechanism.
Yeah.
So
it's
based on U-matic. It's like a mini U-matic, yeah.
Yes, the whole machine.
By the way, I have to tell you a story about your dual recording.
Yeah.
You know, these days we don't use things like this anymore for field recording. We use basically hard drive machines, solid state machines, things like that.
Yeah.
So I've been using sound devices machines for 16 years now. And I always record redundantly to the hard drive.
Oh, yeah.
And a compact flash card.
Absolutely.
Many people don't. They just go to the hard drive.
Right.
Well, having made thousands of recordings, field recordings that way, I had one instance where there was a glitch on the hard drive, and I saved a recording with the compact flash card.
Yep. That's it.
One time it happened.
As soon as you stop doing it redundantly, you start having glitches.
Times. Right.
That's when you have the headaches and the failures. Yeah. All right, great. Well, we should have said something about this concerning where we were going to go into the DAT modem, medium. We should do something on that too. Maybe some sort of presentation between the three of us concerning the different machines.
Well, I think digital formats. Because you mentioned the number D, right?
Right.
So we talk a lot about number D. Yeah. I actually own two of them.
I'm up to my eyeballs in phono EQ right now.
Yeah.
I can see that.
Beg pardon?
I'm having fun with it, too.
Anyway, let me conclude everything here. Thank you, Joe.
Thank you all.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Gary. Next meeting is going to be on a Thursday now, folks. Whoops. Oh, it's one of those things I have to really have it in front of me that I can hear it. Okay. Our next program will be on Thursday, November 17th with Matt Barton, who is the head of publications of ARSC. And because of him and his committee, last year ARSC had issued, and I have copies here, of the first compact disc issued by this by our organization because the copyright laws were changed. Thanks to the copyright committee headed by Tim Brooks at the time, it was a congressional amendment. In fact, President Trump had signed it, that everything prior to 100 years from issue is now in the public domain. So we put out a CD, and he's going to talk about it, presenting the winter 2021-22 compact disc issue of the Ars Journal, an international tour of pre-1923 sound and music, finally, in the public domain, curated from the collections of ARSC's members, fully annotated and illustrated in the pages of the journal of issue number 53.3. It'll be a fascinating talk. We're working on now getting the next one ready, which will bring us through to 2023, through 1923. And he will talk about it. He's a great presenter. And he knows, he has gone to various people, various groups. Among the classical people, he has talked to Dennis, myself, and Gary concerning what could go on there, since we had made some suggestions for the first one. And then he has other groups of people who have different interests, and we'll have all that kind of different varied material on it. Everything from vaudeville to jazz to popular, even routines, comedy routines of that sort, along with the classical. So anyway, I'll say it again. It'll be on Thursday, November 17th with Matt Barton. At this time right now, we have nothing scheduled for December. If there's any ARSC member out there in the internet world, on the streaming world, who would like to come in and give a program, please get in contact with us. You can either get me at sethbwinner@optonline.net. That would be the best bet. And get in contact with me, and then see if anybody wants to give a program. Otherwise, next month may be the last one for a little while. All right, everyone, thank you for coming, all five of us here, as they say. And as we say the next time, we're starting into the holiday season. Enjoy the holidays. Thanks.